I wanna, this is almost like a new beginning. So I'm gonna challenge you with some things. I'm excited about today's message. I've been in it for a while now, and I'm already up to chapter 10. So with this book that I'm reading right now with Kevin Connor, and you guys know what God's doing and how this all came about. If you was here last week, I kind of told you, but I want to read some things to you. Now listen, I want you to pay attention, which I know you normally do, but I really want to explain to you really what the church is. So if somebody asked you, what is the church? You know, literally and physically, what is the church? So it's a mystery that's been hidden for ages, okay? But we know that Peter unlocks it. God, Jesus gives him the keys. And the first place we actually see the church in the new covenant mentioned is actually in Matthew chapter 16. And I'm going to show you that. But what I want to do is I'm going to lay down some foundational stuff I want to read to you out of Kevin Connor's book. Highlight a few things before I get into it, because you're going to find out that it's really all about a marriage.
Yeah.
Everything. And what's been hidden for ages has been revealed. And you're going to see some amazing stuff, I promise you. So I want to lay out some ground rules. I'm going to go read a couple of paragraphs from his foreword, which is really good. And then we're going to dive right into the church and its pattern and what it's supposed to look like and what is it. And it's going to be really good. Bob, can you hear me? Brother Bob, you can hear me?
Yeah.
Okay, good deal. So guys, let's get started. I'm going to read a couple of things from the foreword to you. I'm not promising I'm going to get crazy today, but you know, because I really want to teach you guys something so you'll know. So let's pray. Father, in Jesus' name, Lord, you are amazing. Father, we ask right now, Father, that your spirit would just open our ears and our eyes, Father, to see you and hear you. Father, open our hearts, Lord, to be able to receive your word. Father, you are good, Lord. And Father, we love your presence. Father, we ask that you be with us today. We thank you for your son. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Let me read something to you. It is important to understand. It is important to know and understand what God is saying to our generation and what God's purpose is in the earth in our days. We need biblical concepts in order to build according to God's pattern and his purpose. So you have, you know, there's all kind of things we're going to get into, and I don't want to get ahead of myself, but you know, you're really going to get to see what God has called us to do as an individual. It says, in connection with the above, the first thing we see about pastors in the church, Jeremiah talks about it, and he says something. It says, the scriptures reveal in Jeremiah chapter 1, he says that Jeremiah's ministry was twofold in two stages. Number one, stage one, Jeremiah had to root out and pull down and destroy and throw down. That was the first part. Jeremiah, what was going on with Jeremiah? There was rotten pastors.
Yeah.
There was rotten pastors that was just leading the sheep astray, taking their money, all of this stuff, you know, just like today, ain't no different. So God called Jeremiah, number one, to root out, to pull down, to destroy, and to throw down. And number two, Jeremiah then was to build and to plant. So after he tore down and did what God commanded, then he's going to build and plant. It says, so we say there are two various concepts in the church that we have today. It says, first we have to be, there's some that's going to be rooted out, pulled down, destroyed and thrown down, right? Before God can build and plant the truth concerning his church. Now let me tell you what Jeremiah says. Check this out. It says, the great shaking. This church is shaken quite a few times.
Yeah.
God has called us to do, you know, a few things that has shook the church from, you know, a full house to what you see now,
yeah. Right?
That filled all these chairs plus some,
right?
But listen what he says. True church. The great shaking. In connection with the above, Jeremiah's ministry, the scripture also shows us that everything is to be shaken that can be shaken. Nations, governments, philosophies, denominations, cultures, people, traditions of men, doctrines, concepts, and values will be shaken.
Yeah.
And are being shaken like never before. The Bible says, before the Lord returns, the earth will be shaken. The nation of Israel will be shaken. The heavens will be shaken. Everything that can be shaken will be shaken. The church will be shaken. Right? It says, we're living in that period of human history when many traditions and concepts are being shaken. Or being rooted out. Now, you find out that you've been taught a certain way, or you learned a certain way, just because the pastor's up here preaching to you and telling you these things. But as you begin to get in your word for yourself, you realize, wow, you know, it ain't quite like they had put it,
yeah.
Right?
Right.
So now you have to deal with that doctrine that you've been taught. So it says, we're living in a period of human history when many traditions and concepts are being shaken, things that are being rooted out. Wow, we experienced that, huh?
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
It says, that's being torn down, plucked up and destroyed. This has been before the Lord can build and plant the truth. The only unshakable thing is the church in the kingdom of God. If I say kingdom to you, do you know what the word kingdom means? The kingdom, it's derived of two words. The king's domain. It's the king's domain. Man, if you just think about that and go back and reread, the kingdom of heaven is likened unto, man, it'll change the way you think about some of those parables, right? So, let's see. I'm going to just catch this. I got two paragraphs to read to you from chapter 1, and then we're going to jump right into chapter 2, and I promise you it's going to get really good. Quick. Check this out. The church and the gospels. Now, let me tell you something about the church. The church is actually a mystery that has been hidden from the ages. It's always been God's plan from the very beginning. And you're going to see the church in the Old Covenant manifested over and over and over again. And that's why Paul, when he got this divine revelation, he talks about in Ephesians about, you know, the church was a mystery that was hidden right after he's talking about the marriage. He's talking about the marriage in Ephesians 4 and 5. And he goes from right into the marriage straight into the mystery of the kingdom that is revealed now is all about a marriage. That's all it's about. The church and the gospels. There are two specific references to the church in the gospels. It's in Matthew 16 and Matthew 18. These are both found in the Gospel of Matthew. It says, the background of Christ's promise to build his church is significant. The Gospel of Matthew is distinctly the gospel of the kingdom. Now, let me just throw something at you right here real quick. It says that Christ would build his church. That's interesting because when I was reading, it brought me back to something that I had studied a long time ago. The Bible says that God formed Adam out of the dust of the ground, but he made Eve. Totally two different words. Totally different. In fact, he formed Adam, which means as in his image, but he says he made Eve. It's the Hebrew word which means to build or builded or erect or assemble or to put together. Wow. all the way in the very beginning, where we look at, you know, the nation of Israel leaving Egypt and God choosing the nation of Israel, you know, as his chosen people, that was part of the plan. The plan was that God would choose a people from the nations to be his bride. That's what it's all about. It's all about a marriage. The gospel, when the gospel is preached, what is it? It's a wedding proposal. You can accept it or reject it. It's the king that's, you know, asking you, will you marry me? That's what the gospel is. Pretty crazy stuff, huh? So check this out. We know that the two Adams are alike. The first Adam, right? And the last Adam. It says that God had to lay down Adam, right, to pull his bride out of his side, right? He builded a bride for Adam. Kind of sounds funny, right? Pretty amazing that right now God is building. Jesus said, I will build my church upon this rock. What is he doing? Building a bride. Making a bride for himself. That's the mystery of the ages. In fact, the kingdom and the mystery that God had planned, you can go all the way back that God had a plan because he formed Adam and pulled Eve, a bride, out of his side. We can go through the scriptures now looking at everything and you'll be able to see God's plan was to pull a bride from the nations. And that's what it's all about. I remember Holly told me yesterday, you know, God's doing a big thing right now. So expect the enemy to attack. And I'll tell you how God confirms it. I was talking to, you know, a man last night about a marriage, right? Holly was talking to me yesterday about, just off the blue, this girl from years ago at 2:30 in the morning texted John. You know, just why? You know, it's a marriage. She said, now, you know, I would have been mad before, but I know it's the enemy. And I know, you know, John didn't do anything and all this kind of stuff. But it's all about a marriage. It's all about you and I being faithful to the one that's called us. Now listen, you can be faithful to the one that's called you, or you can be unfaithful or faithless. Right? So it's all up to you. How many people in here would, you know, keep their husband or wife if all they did was run around on them? Anybody? No hands, huh? Neither would I. Right? Jesus won't either. You have been called to be faithful unto the one that's called you. And if you're not faithful to him, well then you're unfaithful. And then isn't it crazy in the Bible, we start getting the kingdom of heaven or the parable of the 10 virgins and the bridegroom coming. For what? His bride. It's all about Jesus Christ coming, 1 Corinthians 15, he's coming for a bride without spot or wrinkle. Man, that gets into something else. But the mystery of the ages that Paul began to reveal to the Jews, thought they was the chosen ones selected out of all the world. Yeah, they were. But what was hidden inside of that was that God was going to choose, the Bible says through Abraham, remember? Here, I'm going to throw some stuff at you. It's going to make you think before I get into the message. Right? Watch this. Pretty amazing. It says, look at Abraham. Abraham sought a city whose builder and maker was God. I want you to think about this. Come and let me show you the Lamb's bride. And he took me to the new holy city, Jerusalem. Think about that. Abraham is looking for a city whose builder and maker is God. What is he actually looking for? An assembly of those who love him. One, the Bible says through Abraham, not the nation would be blessed. This is I'm talking to you about the church in the old covenant. Through Abraham, the nations would be blessed because he would choose a remnant out of the nations. So here it is, the church means called out ones, right?
Yeah.
Abraham was called out of Babylon. You start running through the scriptures and you start looking, wow, God builded a bride for his son. And that's what he's doing right now. When you start going through the scriptures, even if we look at Noah, how does Noah's ark represent the church? How can you see Christ in it? Well, let me tell you, first thing is, when God told Noah to build the ark, did he leave anything up to Noah to build?
No.
Did he say, Noah, look, build me a boat. Do it however you want. No, he was very specific in the pattern of how to build what was going to bring salvation. Just like God was very specific to Moses when he said, build it this way. This is what you do. Don't change from it. Don't differ. Let me tell you something about Moses. Moses was a master builder. He was experienced in all of the knowledge of the Egyptians.
Yeah.
When God told David to build his house, he gave David the blueprints, the pattern on how the house was to be built. Left nothing up to David. Left nothing up to Solomon. Left nothing up to Noah. Left nothing up to Moses. Because he knows how he's going to build his house. And that's why Paul said, being a wise master builder, watch who builds on your foundation. Because you are the house of God. Wow, yeah. Things start connecting now. You are a building assembled together. Now, they got a lot of people who assemble and come together, but they form nothing.
Right.
A pile of rocks doesn't make it a house. A pile of wood doesn't make it a house. A pile of stones doesn't make an altar. It's got to be assembled a certain way.
Right.
And that's what God is doing, assembling his bride. He builded a bride for Adam to erect it, to build it. To make one fit just for him. And that's why everything in the Old Covenant, in the Mosaic Law, when you look in it, you find God's got a purpose. And that purpose is to get a bride for his son, a faithful bride. Faithful. So when God says Jesus was a carpenter, he was a master builder. You think that's by chance? No. So when he starts talking about, Paul says, you know, as a wise master builder. When Jesus says, you know, and I, you know, he starts giving you the illustration of a man who builds his house on the stone. Who is the man that builds his house on the stone? It's him. He is the stone. He is the builder. Didn't they reject the builder?
Mm-hmm.
He is the builder that they rejected. Where they thought they had salvation and all of these things in the Mosaic Law, the Mosaic Covenant was an old wineskin. But hidden within the Mosaic Covenant was a church called out of Egypt, separated unto God. As a chosen people was just a foreshadow of what God was going to do out of the nations. But yet, because of unbelief and faithlessness, only two that left Egypt over the age of 20 entered, Joshua and Caleb.
Amen.
This is for you and me today. To realize that, you know, I just got to ask the question. Craziness, you know, just a young lady asked me a question. She said that a question that was asked her in this questionnaire that was given to her. She was applying for a job. In this question, can you be saved by grace alone? Can you be saved? That was the question. How do you answer that? Can you be saved by grace alone? Well, that's not the fullness of the scripture. By grace through faith.
Right.
Which keeps you going. And that, because you are the one, you are the spiritual house that God is assembling you and me together so that he has a place to live. We're going to get into some good stuff. Watch this. It says, the background of Christ's promise to build his church is significant. The Gospel of Matthew is distinctly the gospel of the kingdom. Jesus Christ, the seed of Abraham and of David, the king of the kingdom, came to his own people, Judah, and presented them the kingdom of God. Right? Jesus preached, taught, and demonstrated the power of that kingdom, but the Jews generally hardened their hearts to the king and his kingdom, which he had come to establish. It was not the type of kingdom that they expected. They looked for a kingdom like David that would come and overthrow the Romans and kick them out, right? Jesus, however, presented them a spiritual and heavenly kingdom that can only be entered by repentance and faith. By repentance and faith. They got to operate together, right? Jesus, however, presented a spiritual and heavenly kingdom that could not only be entered by repentance. Jesus, however, presented a spiritual and heavenly kingdom that could only be entered in by repentance and by faith. Hence, blindness and hardness of heart and spiritual deafness settled upon the Jewish nation. The Sanhedrin took counsel together to crucify the king. The kingdom of God was then taken from them and given to a nation that would bring forth fruits. Right? But blindness in part, Paul says in Romans 11, happened to the Jews so that the Gentiles could be engrafted in. Right?
Right.
That's the mystery of the kingdom. That brings us back to Noah's Ark. The clean animals and the unclean animals coming into the ark represents the Jews and the Gentiles. So the church, the formation of the church, goes all the way back to the very beginning. Even with Abraham being called out of the Ur of the Chaldeans, being called out, God made him a promise. Through faith, he inherited it.
Yeah.
Right? But unto him, the nations would be blessed. So his first son is Isaac. Right? So his, Abraham's head, the head man of his house, has to go look for a bride for Isaac. That's the whole thing. When you start going through the stories, God is looking for a bride for his son. That's what we've been called. So Abraham sends Eleazar, his head servant, to go get a bride. And then he says, Lord, he goes to the well, Rebekah's at the well. Remember?
Yeah.
And he says, Lord, if I found favor in your sight, and this is the girl, when I ask for her to draw water for me, Eleazar's name means helper. Romans 8, the Holy Spirit is our helper. He's looking for a bride.
Yeah.
Let her also draw water for my 10 camels. So not only do you have to serve the Spirit, right?
Yeah.
But the Spirit wants to see if you're going to serve his beasts of burden. Others.
Yeah.
And let me tell you about that. The other 10 camels on their backs were the gifts.
Yeah.
That was coming to the bride.
Right.
If she would have served only the Spirit, gave him some water, and never drew the water out for the 10 camels, she wouldn't have got the gifts.
Right.
Pretty crazy, huh? So God is called. He's looking for a bride that serves. Where? In his house. What house? Right here. His house. Not this building. This building is just a building where we assemble.
Right.
We're the church.
Yeah. Right.
Made up of lively stones in which now God dwells.
Right.
He says, It says, it was in this background, in the setting at Caesarea Philippi, that Jesus prophesied of the building of his church. Remember Jesus when it says, check this out. This is really good too. When it's right before Passover, okay? And Jesus is going to build his church, right? So it says, in 6 days prior to, in Matthew chapter 16 through 18, you'll see, and after 6 days, Jesus taketh Peter, James, and John up to a high mountain, right? But while he was at the foot of the mountain, he says something which is pretty amazing. He says, when at the foot of the mountain, there's this gate which is called the gateway to hell. Literally there. They call it the gateway or the passageway to hell. There's a big iron gate in front of it too, in the side of the mountain, in Caesarea Philippi. I went there. But anyway, Jesus, asks Peter, who do you say that I am? And Peter announces, thou art the Christ. That's a big thing. The Son of the living God. And he says, and upon this rock, right, he's going to build his church. But he points to something and he says, and the gates of hell would not prevail against it. Now, that's an amazing statement. And the gates of hell would not prevail against it. What's so amazing about that is that that's where people assembled at. When anything was going to go down, if they was going to take down a kingdom, they assembled at the gate. If there was any transaction, it was at the gate. Remember with Ruth and Boaz, where did he stood? Took the shoe off? At the gate. It was a meeting place. It was a gate where the enemy would try to come in. And Jesus is saying, and the gates of hell would not prevail against his church, which he's fixing to build. He says, therefore Christ promised, and the promise becomes the prophecy that upon this rock I will build my church. It will no longer be the church built by and upon Moses. It would be a church that was built by and upon Christ, to whom Moses pointed. It would no longer be the old covenant church of the chosen nation of Israel, but a new covenant church chosen out of every people, tongue, and nation. That was just, I wanted to kind of give you a background of what the church is and what the church is not, and what God is actually looking for. And God has given us his pattern on how to build his church. There's all kind of, things that are out there that appear to be his church. But we have patterns that are set up in front of us. How the church is to be built. How the house is to be assembled. Which you are that house. And it's pretty amazing because where we're going to, it says, chapter 2, it says, building according to his pattern. You know how many people out there that are building not according to his pattern? What if I said building an orphanage? Man, that's a good thing. What if I said I want to build a medical clinic? What if I said I wanted to build a school to teach people about Jesus? Is that what God actually called us to build? It's a good thing. But what did he call us to build? You and I. Build each other. Ephesians 4. He calls us, same word, to edify. And he says, to build. Right?
Yeah.
So that what? So that God can dwell within his body. Within his church. Do you know that's the same word to build in Ephesians 4 is the same word in Genesis when he made Eve. Same word. He's building a bride for himself. It's pretty crazy. Right? So y'all ready? Let's get into the pattern. It says, we're going to build according to the pattern. I said that it's a new beginning. God is doing something right now. He is, you know, providing. The Spirit is moving. He's showing us things that is like, man, only He can do. Making provision for His house so that, you know, He can do what it is that He wants to do. God is all about people, about edifying, encouraging, and building each other up. People get caught up and go and build big buildings, big churches, building something down the street, building, you know, something that'll help people, you know, whatever it is. There's a lot of things out there that is good, and maybe there's nothing wrong with it. And I don't see anything wrong with it. But are you building according to the pattern that God has called you to build? So that when you become mature, now God is dwelling in His house. Remember, in Ephesians 4, it was to build them for what? The work of the ministry. Check this out. It's all about a bride. Remember I told you that if we want to look at the Lamb's wife, they took him, it says that the angel took John and showed him the new holy city, Jerusalem. A city, the new holy city, Jerusalem, right? So he connected the Lamb's bride to the new holy city, Jerusalem, where it says and talks about how we're all lively stones fitted together for the habitation of the Lord, where He dwells inside of you and me. So when God designed His tabernacle, right? And Solomon's temple, the priests that worked inside the house, they were actually the Lamb's bride working inside the temple and the tabernacle, just like it is for you and I today, working inside of one another, building one another. What is it that we're supposed to be doing? Well, number one, we got to know the pattern. So the pattern's got to be set up in you. And that's why I'm taking you with all of this. So this pattern, you have to know. It's no different than your house. If your bride is in your house, you know everything about the house. You know how the bride operates the house. The bride runs the house. The bride does the groceries, does the clothes. She sets everything in order. That's the same way God set it up. That's us. God put His bride over His church to run His house, to keep everything in order, to build it according to His plan and what He said. Watch this. It says, if the Lord Jesus Christ is going to build His church, it is basic that He, as a wise master builder, will build it according to the divine pattern. So we're going to get into this. I ain't going to get far into today. But we're going to start going through each divine pattern so that when it's done and finished, you're going to know what the church is. You're going to know what it is that you've been called to do beyond a shadow of a doubt. You're going to know what the church is not. And you only know it through the patterns that God has put for us. Listen to this. We get into just the introduction of it. Chapter 2 just starts it. Building according to the pattern. Don't you want to know if you're building right or not?
Yeah.
If the Lord Jesus Christ is going to build His church, it is basic that He, as a wise master builder, will build it according to the divine pattern, to God's design or blueprint. Before any builder commences building, he draws up a plan, a design, to which he intends to build. And all other builders, subcontractors, listen to this, all other builders and subcontractors build according to the pattern. I know I was a superintendent. That's what I did. All my subcontractors had to follow the blueprints. If we follow the blueprints, man, the blueprints, the word, the pattern, the design. But what's happened is the pattern, the true pattern, has gotten off. How does the true pattern get off? Denominations.
Yeah.
Denominations are built on truths. Denominations separate the bride. Denominations doesn't gather, it scatters.
Right.
Denominations don't assemble. They only assemble with themselves. Wow. The church that we build in is not the Citadel Church or the Baptist Church or the Pentecostal Church or the Lutheran Methodist. It's the church of Jesus Christ.
Right.
His church. But if I even said, you know, well, what church, first thing somebody asks you, what church you go to? Why? To put you in a category, to mark you. If you go to Baptist, I'm Pentecostal. I can't associate with you. That's crazy. So what has happened is, if you're Pentecostal, you believe a certain way, you built on that way. I'm sorry to say that you got to tear some things down and get back building on Jesus Christ.
Right.
Because with Jesus Christ, He brings us together as a lively stone, building a house,
yeah.
Not many houses of habitation, a house, His house.
Yeah.
That's when you know. Man, can you get together with Baptists and Pentecostal and Methodists and Lutheran and all these different denominations and love them and everything's great? Absolutely. But let me tell you something. Denominations, if they know you believe a certain way, that's why they first thing they come out and ask you, what church you go to? Whoa. And if you ain't part of that church, or that denomination, you are an outcast. You won't be accepted. You won't be hired at a job. Yes. That's kind of crazy stuff. Man, that's... So men build denominations. But Christ builds His church. And let me tell you about that. There's a remnant that's everywhere that understands that. That's not under one certain name. Because if I said, you know, I go under the name, I build under the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, they would say, oh, all the Latter-day Saints.
Yeah, right.
Right? No. That's how crazy it's gotten. Right? So it's crazy. But when you find out the truth, man, it doesn't matter who you are. What... Where you assemble. You see, there's churches, there's one church, but the body gathers and assembles all over the place. All over the place they assemble. They come together so that God can work in them. But if they can't have fellowship with you, right? Something is wrong. Watch. It's the same thing that Jesus encountered. Soon as he got there to the, you know, to the house of God, bam, they wanted him out of there. He says, no good builder ever gathers a lot of material and builds at random. The materials must be placed according to the blueprint. A heap of stones is not a house. Neither is a bulk of material on a piece of land a house. All the material must be assembled in its proper and respective place to build according to the pattern that the architect has given us. That's why it's not a one-man show. The Bible says, let the prophet speak two or three, let the other judge. The ascension gifts that he gave us before he left, they called the ascension gifts the fivefold ministry. He that descended is the one that ascended. But first, before he ascended into heaven, they call it the ascension gifts, he gave gifts unto men. To do what? To build his church. Apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, teachers, right? To perfect them, to edify them, to build them, till they become mature. Why? for the work of the ministry. What ministry? His ministry, his church, working and serving. Let me tell you something. And I'm not going to go any further. That's only just the first paragraph up in there. I want to tell you how amazing things have become here recently. The growth just in the people themselves with, you know, this time of transition that this church just came out of you guys pouring your love on us, I mean, has been absolutely amazing because you know what God called us to do, right? So your help, man, from buying me shoes, you know, I don't take a salary. I don't take, you know, 5 years. But it's not about that. It's about you guys walking up and giving, meeting the need, because that's what God has called us to do more than anything else, to build up each other. I've watched God just begin to pour blessings out on you guys that is like just, man, amazing. And now I'm watching it. My brother calls me up. Here's one. God's blessing him, right? So he calls me up and he says, man, I want to give to this one and give to that one. And I got my own bills. And I want to give to this one. You know, the very thing that he's talking about, Michelle and Jason, the very thing that he's talking about, I said, brother, you're doing exactly what it is that God has called you. You're doing the work of the ministry. When you see someone in need and you can meet it, meet it. Edify them. Help them. And it's like now, you know, I watched John give, you know, Nick a truck. It just, and it goes way deeper than that. I mean, everybody has stepped up, and but that's what this little body has so pulled together to help one another. That's what the church is about. Listen to me. Before you go give to the guy on the street corner, and before you see somebody on TV and just throw your money at them, man, don't do it. Let the Lord lead you.
Yeah.
Let the Lord, and not only with money. I mean, Madge gets knocked down, or this one gets knocked down. Next thing you know, man, we got a group of people that's sending food to their houses.
Yeah.
That's what the body is really supposed to be.
Yeah.
We're really supposed to be a family that loves one another and cares for one another and helps one another and serves one another. Because there is no titles in here.
Right.
We're all servants. I'm not greater than you. You're not greater than me. We're all servants. We're all brides. Waiting for the bridegroom to come back for us. And all I want to do is do what it is that God has called me to do. And then, if I have the ability, and I see you trying to do something, well then, and I can help you, well then I'll help you do it. And that's how we begin to serve one another. And that's the only way you can serve Christ.
Amen.
You know that?
Yeah.
That's the only way. So by John helping me, and all of these blessings and back and forth and all of this, all the gifts now begin to start moving and operating. Not only the physical, but the spiritual gifts that God has given us to where, hey, I could spend some time getting a word so that I got a real word for you. A word that God is speaking right now, that what God is doing and what He's wanting to do right now. and that some big things are in front of us right now. It's going to be an amazing year spiritually. Amazing year. Telling you. And either you're going to be a part of it or you're going to miss it. But I know everybody in here is going to be a part of it. I see it.
Amen.
And you know what? Let me tell you something. God shook this church again, son. He shook it again. That's why he says he's going to shake everything that can be shaken. And it's so good when you can hear. I'm up there next to John, man, and just little words in a song, he cracks a smile. I say, what? Whether it's here or, you know, it's at his house, or it's amazing to see when your eyes are really open to the truth. Like, wow. That's what I hear him say. Nah, because I do it all the time. My brother starts singing something, you know, and then all of a sudden, you've been singing that song forever. And then all of a sudden, I get it. you really get and understand what it is that he's actually really singing about. What you thought you did before, man, the gates is like, boom, wow, I get it. You know, it happened to me. This song, my brother started singing with Jason Upton. What was it? The song was by the house, used by the house. It was, boy, I told you, brother, I understand what that is. What was that song you were singing? But anyway, he started singing a song. And it was, Jason Upton was singing. And
he's got to play the guitar for a minute.
Yeah,
so he can remember.
Yeah. I'm going to let him get it. Because... What's that? Right. So anyway, you know, he started singing this song in the house the other day. And Jason Upton, and I kind of vaguely remember what it was about. It was about decisions that he had to make. Is it you or is it, how's it go, brother? Turn that mic on. Turn his mic on. And we'll end with this. Listen to this. This is it.
Father, I'm waiting. I need to hear from you. To know that you're approving of what I say and do.
Stop. Stop. Man.
Your sister
flawed. Nothing really satisfies.
Hold up. Hold up, brother. I gotta get myself.
You gotta be able to breathe.
You know, I know where that song come from. When he was singing that song. Because in decisions in your life, you know, in your life and in my life, and especially as a pastor of this church, the decisions that I make, I really need to know if it's him.
Amen.
And that was what happened, just what happened recently with the move and the transition. And when God says, you know, I want you to stop. No more. It's shut down. It's over. It's done. And you're going to have to trust in me. I'm like, is that really you? I mean, these songs is coming out of people. It's not just a good pop song. It's coming out of decisions and prayer. That song is a prayer. Asking the Lord. I can't tell you how many times I ask the Lord, am I right in your eyes? Am I doing what I'm supposed to be doing? Do you approve of what I'm doing? I needed to hear from him. I needed to hear from him with decisions that I make. Checking myself. Am I right? Am I doing right? Because listen to me. I'm building on you.
Amen. Amen.
And you are God's house. Am I building wood, hay, and stubble so that when it passes through the fire, I'm going to be held accountable for it? Or am I building precious stones, gold and silver, that passes through the fire? People will get up and spit words out to people and all of these kind of things. They don't even know what they're doing. No accountability. It's a serious thing. That's why Paul said, be careful who builds upon your foundation. They got people building out there, don't even read the Bible. They have no idea of the sacrifice and the commitment it takes to walk for the Lord. It's easy to die for Jesus. Try living for Him. And then start tearing down traditions of men. And see what happens.
Come on, brother.
Well, look around you. How many empty chairs is there? Preach the truth. You know what I used to think? Lord, I'm going to preach the truth, man. The house is going to be packed. Man, the people are just going to be... I'm going to be going around the world. They're going to be inviting me all over the place. Did the Lord said, church started out, we grew. Bam! Filled all 83 chairs. Had an order, got 40 more. The gray ones that's in the back in storage. Had people standing up in the back. Church was packed, moved into another place. All right.
You ain't gonna have church on Sunday no more. You're moving it to Friday night.
What?
We're gonna shake them loose.
How many people left the church? Man, they were dragging me into counseling because I wasn't having church on Sunday. Oh my God, son.
Amen.
Because I just simply said, and I quote, God told me, He wants us to gather together on Friday nights, eat supper together as a family.
Amen.
To get to know one another so we're not running out the door on Sunday to get to the chicken buffet place.
Yeah.
Well, about 30 or so walked out the door with that one.
Yeah.
Because simply, I said, we're going to have church on Friday and not Sunday. That was heresy. Oh. And then, after about a year, the Lord said,
we're going to shake it again.
I'm like, I just laughed. I said, what's up now?
We're going to Saturdays.
I'm like, oh my Lord, now I'm a Sabbath keeper. I'm a Latter-day Saint. And I'm going to hear everything with this now.
We're going to shake everything that can be shaken.
Amen.
Just because I was... I was brought before my pastor and asked if I was losing my mind.
Come on, brother.
Pastor Allen. Watch this, Pastor Allen. Are you all right, brother? Look, this Pastor Allen. Are you all right?
But in his defense, he didn't think you were really losing your mind.
He said, man, Pastor Allen, he's amazing. He said, sit down. And he just paused like that. I've been hearing some things. Are you all right?
time.
Hey, that wasn't only the first time.
Yeah.
The second move, I got visited. He drove from Resurrection to Poplarville. Are you really trying to build a church? Because what you're doing, everybody's going to leave. Are you all right, brother? Said, yeah, man, you know me. I'm good.
Amen.
I just got to do what Jesus told me to do.
Amen.
But that's a phase up. Well, you ain't building. They all leaving. I know.
They doing
remnant made. Man. Being obedient to what God calls you to do and tells you to do, man.
Amen.
Hey, really? Really? But number one.
I did a lot when I
you know, you can't, they got people that say some crazy things out there, really.
Amen.
God told me. And it don't even line up with the word.
No.
It don't even line up with the word. But anyway, so I'm going to end with that. You know, right now it's a new beginning and a fresh start. God is doing some amazing things right now. We're going to get into next week. We're going to get into this altar, the laver, the lampstand, showbread table. We're going to get into God's pattern, God's way of building. And that's how we're going to build.
And,
right. Don't even say it.
She just asked, we're not switching again.
No, we're not switching again. But anyway, so let's pray. Father, you're good. Father, we love you. We thank you for just all you are, Father. Lord, we want to be led by your Spirit. But also, Father, we want to know that it's you leading us too. And we know it's you, Father. So, Lord, get us in order, Lord, and fill us, Lord, so that... we can do the work of the ministry. In Jesus' name, amen. 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 Amen.